So hello and welcome to our second April is ASC month. It is Tuesday, April 13th, and we're very, very glad to have you here. We really appreciate everyone being here, and I hope last week's meeting was useful for you. And my name is Kelly Caudill, and hopefully all of you know me. I'm the main contact here at Stanley Community College. We have on here from Stanley multiple folks. You'll see Gonda with his Ebola shield on. We've got Brandon Crump. Beside his brother, Brian Crump. Brian is going to present today on equipment ordering and NetAcad maintenance. And then Adam Carricker is here. Adam there is in the blue shirt is technically, he's the new Merlin. The new Rita, not the new Merlin. Devin Malcolm is our new Merlin. Tim, they do look related, don't they? No doubt. Our Michael Bowden, who was here last week, is not here today. He had his second COVID shot yesterday and is succumbed to the day two Moderna chills and sickness. So just to let you know, if you are getting your second Moderna shot, I would probably plan to take the next day off because most people I have run into have had at least a little bit of a side effect the day after. Today, we're going to be hearing from Monica Gomez. Monica is the CSR manager and partner development manager. I'm covering the biggest area that I know that works for me is in Florida and other areas. And so Monica will be discussing the CSR update. And then again, Brian is going to do a look at equipment ordering and NetAcad maintenance to give you an overview of that process. Again, as we all know, that is something taking place, especially if you're like us, you're trying to spend what little bit of money is left or trying to find somewhere to put your COVID grant funds that you've received. I will then do a deep dive into DevNet and the DevNet beta pod. And I know many of you know about DevNet, but I still want to show it to you and show you the beta pod that's being developed by NDG and talk about the different ways to do the labs in DevNet. And then finally, we'll have Q&A for about 15 minutes or more. I mean, we can hang around more if you want and ask questions of me and the leadership team and so on and so forth. I just want to jump forward real quickly just to show next week, April 20th, will be our final, quote, Cisco ASC day that we're going to have. I changed the setup for next week because I really felt like that we needed to use this opportunity with this many of you here to have a roundtable with us and Jesse and Monica and Marie. And if Monica and Marie and Jesse can't make it, then it will be recorded. So they will be able to review it, as will their leadership. So we're going to have 30 minutes and it may be, it ends up being more that we decide that Cisco Modeling Labs is not as important as giving just a good QA roundtable. So next week we will have our final, what I call the Cisco portion of the month. And then on April 27th, we're going to have, I've had commitments from the VMware Academy, the Palo Alto Academy, and the Red Hat Academy to present on updates for those, because that was one of the things that was asked in my setup is, could we bring in other Academy programs? And quite honestly, we support all of them. So we're doing that on the final week, which will be the 27th. So that's where we're going right now. I'd like to introduce again Monica Gomez. Monica is a CSR manager and partner development manager with Cisco. She handles Florida and what other states, Monica? I don't remember exactly all the states.
Tennessee, Alabama, Mississippi, and the Hispanic communities.
Okay, so all of those. We have academies in every one of those. In fact, we have several in Alabama. They're very good. Calhoun's been with us for a long time that has been there. So without further ado, Monica, I'll let you can share your screen and
sure.
I will stop sharing and then that way you can share your screen and we'll get started.
Let me see.
Real quick, folks, if you have a question, feel free to put it in chat. If it's a long question, put in chat that you need to unmute yourself and then you will, we'll let you unmute and we'll go from there, so.
Okay, can you see my screen, my PowerPoint?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Okay, excellent. So perhaps not all of you were here in the first session last week. So I'm going to present myself. I'm this person here. Well, you can see that my natural hair is curly as it is now. So I'm managing the Gulf Coast states, Florida, Alabama, Mississippi, Tennessee. And as you can see, also the Hispanic communities, as well as Claydene is taking care of the tribals, the native tribals, and Jesse's taking care of the HBCUs. I take care of the Hispanic communities. So, and well, my counterpart, Marie Zwicker, she's gonna be with you and perhaps with Jesse and myself. I will try to accommodate my agenda to be with you in that round table for next week. So just a very fast update. See if I can hide this. Perfect. So as you can see, we are now almost 12,000 academies across the world in over 180 countries. We have served at this point of time now over 13 million students since 1997. You are guys almost 29,000. I think that this year we will end by 29, almost 30,000 instructors across the globe. And we have delivered 155 million online exams up to this point. As you can see in the Americas region, and this is one of our challenges, to try to become, again, the leader of the Americas. Latin America, LATAM has taken the leadership, even of the world right now, for the last three fiscal years. And well, now I think that I would say that now internally, the CEO and all the team is so focused on the US and we have to take advantage of it. So I would say that the end of this fiscal year and the next, I would say couple or 3 years, you're going to see a lot of, I don't know, I would say resources, push, support from Cisco itself, to Cisco Networking Academy US, and we have to take advantage of it. So I wanted to bring you some things that I have been sharing lately with instructors from other geos directly or even with students, just not to go so far. This morning, I was a keynote speaker at the NAF conference here in Miami for a bunch of thousands of high schoolers coming from basically Miami-Dade public schools. And I was sharing some information that I think it's gonna be worthy for you as well. Perhaps some of you or all of you know cyberseek.org. But it is important, you know, that you bring this kind of insights to the students in terms of, for me, in this moment, as I was sharing with them this morning, cybersecurity, I would say, firstly, programming, coding by one side, and then everything that it's related to cybersecurity, cloud, data analytics. So these are the key areas right now, of course, beyond the networks itself that are being the top job titles seek and demanded in the market, no? And we are in an area that it's quite, if you will, hot in this sense, in terms of the number of job openings that are out there. And these are the job titles. So this is the kind of information that if I were a student, I would really appreciate having from my instructors, kind of a guidance of what it is supposed that I should try to, you know, evolve and to go towards. So in this case, Florida, which is one of the largest states for Cisco Networking Academy in US, but not only that, but also for Stanley, coming from, you know, from Kelly's support, it's having a great also number of job openings right now, 23,000 plus. And another interesting thing I wanted to show you is that in the case of Florida, and I can do this for any of the states you're coming from, almost all of these top job titles, cyber's job titles, are addressed or are under or supported by part of our courses, okay? And this is another interesting thing for you to know. So I wanted to update you regarding the learning portfolio. As you can see right now, there's no CCNA security anymore. Now it is the new network security. And well, for those who are coming from Florida, this is gonna sound familiar. So at some point we have here, as well as we have in New Mexico, in California, even in Texas and in Arizona, there are even in the North, in some states of the North, because there are large communities of original Hispanic people that they speak in Spanish. And depending on the age, basically, if we are talking about high schoolers, at some point they need more time than if they were in the elementary school to try to, you know, catch up with English the fastest they can. And it can take a little longer. So that's why I have highlighted here in red all those courses that could be taken even at the same time, no, in Spanish and English, particularly those that are self-enrolled. And this is a great resource for the student because they can be doing the course in English. And if there's a moment that there's anything that they don't really understand, they can always go back to their homologous in Spanish and to see what it is supposed that it said over there. So regarding the data related to Florida, as you can see, these are the numbers by the end of last fiscal year. So we have currently over, we will finish this year with over 10,000 students, but at the end of last fiscal year, we had over 9,600, 16% female. I'm gonna just give you an information that may help you. In Latin America, we have an average of females that it's about 33%. So there's an interesting push being done over there. I think this is part of their success. They are, you know, connecting with communities that they were not the natural ones that were being connected. And the females are really embracing technologies as a great possibility for them to thrive, particularly those that are, you know, succeeding in STEM. Then we have 12% certification ready. Mm. Which is not bad, but could be better. So again, I think this is the kind of push that we need to make. You know, guys, that certifications and are really key right now in order to accelerate the process to being hired by the market. And we have, supported almost 90,000 students in Florida since program inception. We had 120 instructors. Now we have much more because particularly Miami-Dade Public Schools have onboarded several high schools during this fiscal year. So they will just show up in the next slide when we will start next fiscal year.
Monica, quick question from the chat. Mike Smith from Foresight is asking, how does Cisco define certification ready? Is it immediately what when you say that percentage, and that's a good question because last time we had
that's a great question.
What does that mean?
That means that if we take our classification goes from class or student registrant to student participant to student completion ready to cert. What does it mean? Not all the students who have completed a career-ready course are ready for certification because they have perhaps they have made exam, yes, they have passed exam, yes, but not with 75% of the grade. So perhaps they passed with 60%. So they are not really ready to cert, okay?
So then, 12% are those who have passed the final in the course with a 70 or higher.
Exactly. So those are the ones who could go now to a Pearson View Center and to get their certification exam. Exactly. That's the point. So in terms of instructors, we have more females that rather than students in this case, which is not bad. So I would encourage, I have seen some instructors, female instructors attending this meeting. So you could always connect with me and Kellyn to try to see if we can do anything in order to onboard more, more females to the program. We have 59 education partners. So these are learning organizations offering Cisco courses. And we have invested over $35 million here in Florida. And 92% of the US students who completed our career courses leading to certification obtain a job or higher education level. Alrighty. So these are the numbers in terms of how many of these active academies that we have in Florida are supported by Standing, by Kelly, are the ones in blue that you see here, plus six new academies that are not listed here in this official list coming from the end of last year, but have been onboarded recently and have activity already. So he's supporting 24 out of 66 active academies in Florida. In Alabama. So is there anyone from Alabama, just to give the numbers or not? Can you please tell me, Kelly, in the chat, if someone is saying, yes, I am from Alabama. Is there anyone from Alabama? Just not to make it so deeply.
I don't think so.
Okay. So as you can see, these are the stats from Alabama, but you will see that there's a nice growth this year, and I will explain you why. Okay, these are the academies, and these are the two academies supported by Stanley. And Tennessee, it's in fact the second of my largest ones. And as you can see here, we have almost 2,000. Florida had almost 10,000. So it's just a fifth of what we have in Florida. Nevertheless, there's a nice number of current instructors. And I would say that this is one of the states in which we should plan a strategy to make a nicer impact, regardless of the one that we have now, which is not bad at all. So some key points here. So I just took away Mississippi because there are no academies supported by Standing Mississippi at this point. So this shows up how these three states are doing. And as you can see, Alabama has an immense growth in percentage, but not only in percentage, look at this. So Alabama has shown right now, and these numbers are year to date. That means from August to the end of March, okay? I have not even included here April because we are in the middle of April. So the absolute growth has been huge in Alabama, okay? And the reason why mostly is because we started and put in place a very nice project over there, led by Sarah, my counterpart, Civil Air Patrol. And they have onboarded cybersecurity in a great way. I would say that it is 1,700 of these students coming from this unique project. And this is another thing that I would really love to see. You know, if any of you has a specific project that you may think that we could work together, perhaps not in your own institution, but with your collaboration in any other institution that could really, benefit a larger number of students, just let me know and we will work together with Kelly in order to make it happen. So there are other numbers bringing a very nice growth as well. as you can see, get connected. IoT as well, networking essentials, Python, and I have put get connected twice, so I'm wrong here. This was get connected, and the first was Linux. Sorry, this after cyber was meant to be Linux with a huge percentage of growth. Nothing related to this is the other way around, I think. I messed up here. I think that, of course, get connected was 4,200. Growth, and this one here, it was the Linux one with 1,800% growth.
And I want to mention one thing, Monica. The very fact that all three have grown is amazing, and that's big. I know Sergio is here from Pellissippi State, and I just want to say to everyone who's in these states, that's amazing that you're growing at all during COVID, because I know how we're all struggling. So to see growth at all is wonderful, and again, I can't say enough about the Python. We're using that in the state of North Carolina at the high school level for every high school. And so that's something that really helps the student when they get into the two-year and four-year schools. So that's a project if you want to do at your state level that you might know someone that would be willing to do that, then contact us. But just like I said, great job to see growth at all in this situation we're all in.
Definitely. And there's a couple of more things before I keep going that I would like to mention. One is, unfortunately, we keep losing students in IT Essentials. I think that, we are always considering the fact that if we have not addressed correctly how this our course was going to be positioned compared to CompTIAS. In any case, IT Essentials from Cisco Networking Academy is still and will be aligned to the CompTIA Plus certification. And this is something that you all need to know. For sure you are aware of it. And CCNA as well, I think that there has been, and you can see the loss is so little. And we're talking here that we have just lost 10 students, which is almost nothing. So this is basically more than red is, you know, in black. No, we are quite the same as last year. But I would say that this, as Kelly was saying now, this is a huge effort coming from all of you, trying not to, you know, to see students dropping because they cannot come to the lab or they cannot do hands-on activities on the lab and they needed a better connection than the one that they had perhaps from home. And we could not deliver just with Packet Tracer the kind of, you know, quality of activities that could bring them up in terms of skills more than the knowledge. So there's a huge effort done by the community of instructors here, and I really want to acknowledge that to all of you. So some NetAcad projects. I hope that you all are absolutely aware of our HBCU Instructor Training Scholarship. Kelly has sent several emails informing all of you about it. Is anyone not aware of this? Please, can you put it in the chat just to take note of it, and we will address this information to you if you are part of any HBCU. There's a second cohort that will start by May. And then we have Instructor Training Scholarship as well. So as you can see, this will be conducted by Gay Berryman from Region 11 and will be starting in July. And the second one, it's going to be determined. So most likely we'll be offering this second cohort during the month of October 2021. So if you are an HBCU or, important, if you are a PBI, so one of those institutions that has predominantly Black students. So please contact with us, with Kelly and myself and Jesse, so because you can be included in this scholarship program as well.
And I just want everyone
then
to
we have the Learnathon. So I have created a bit. Yes.
One second. On the HBCU scholarships, there are four positions still available in the second cohort of CCNA that begins on May 3rd. If you are a school that serves, an HBCU population and you're not part of the grant, get in contact with me. There are four spots available in the class starting on May 3rd. So thank you.
Excellent. Thank you for this update, Kelly. So then we have the Learnathon. The International Girls in ITC Day is going to take place, as you can see down here, on April 22nd. And I have created, I will send you the PDF, or you can create a PDF as you want, Kelly, because I sent you already this presentation. So you will see there this registration link that will bring you to the website in which you can register if you want to, to take, if you ask me, can boys assist? Oh, yes, they can. So if you have a class that has girls, and of course you have boys as well, and you want them to participate just to have this insight for the girls, to keep encouraging them, and for the boys to start making them understand that time to time they're going to see more girls joining ICTs. So if you want to participate, please just feel free and connect with us through this registration button. And then I wanted to make a little insight on Talent Bridge program. So remember that this is part of the resources that I'm going to list them just in a while. But remember that Talent Bridge program tries to connect all of our students with the employers, okay, within the partner Cisco partner ecosystem, and with our own company as well. So you know where to find it. In the PDF, you will find this QR. So you can even share this with your students in order to allow them to go to the page and to see all these components of Talent Bridge, okay? The first one, as you know, it's a matching engine, okay? So I would encourage you to encourage your own students to take the advantage of, as a student, they can just log in, they can go to careers, they can go to Talent Bridge, and underneath this, they can go to matching engine. This will open them the website for the matching engine. Over there, they can place their profile, they can upload their curriculum, and they can start looking for, making a search on the job openings that are available for them in any geography that they choose, in any company that they choose, or in any kind of, role that they would choose. Remember that the matching engine works in the two directions, all right, in the two senses. That means the student proactively can go there and they can make the search themselves and apply for a job, or they can, vice versa, they can receive weekly a Talent Bridge email to their account, their email account, with the one that they are registered in NetAcad, in order to, not the one that they are logging in NetAcad, but the one that they are placing in the matching engine profile, because I receive it in my personal one, although I'm a user in NetAcad with my Cisco email. So they can receive an email weekly saying, listen, we have made a search for you and these are the openings that are available for you that match somehow with your requirements or the information that you have left regarding what are you really looking for. Okay, so this would be the process for the students and of course for yourselves as well. So the other thing is the LinkedIn channel. Remember that there are 158,000 users Now this screenshot was taken a little ago, so it's not 153,000. Now it's over 158,000 or followers of this channel, and I can tell basically there are over 50,000 alumni from Netacad. So the rest, that means over 108,000, are job seekers. Job seekers are job. Hiring managers and human resources managers and companies and you know, employers that are viewing our alumni and that are connecting with them. In fact, 30,000 of our students have stated that they have been so glad connecting to the market through TalentBridge in the last 4 years. Career preparation workshop. This is a self-enrolled course. Again, this takes between 8 and 10 hours to complete. But the best of it is that this gives the, you know, the students a way to know more about what is a hiring process, how does it work, how do I have to prepare myself, how to get started, what do I have to do first, no? Before the interview or before any test that they're gonna make me. So you have here the link to this self-enrolled course and you can take it at any time, or they can take it at any time. Finally, the top on-demand soft skills. So you are instructors. I'm not gonna give you any lesson here, but I think that this slide could be used by you in the classroom. Today, I saw during the NAF conference where I was presenting that this slide particularly was so interesting for the students, right? So, and there's an explanation that perhaps it's not now the time to make it, but you have to put examples to them in order to let them understand what is business analysis. I was telling them I have never gone to any interview, business interview, you know, job opening as a candidate. I always had to do an analysis about the business, but not only that company, but the sector, right? The field, the area in which this company was, their competitors, their products, how they sell, which is the kind of language they use, no? In what channels do they are? Which are their main, providers or suppliers, or who are the main customers? So these kind of things are the ones that I was telling them. This helps so much when you have perhaps a second or third layer in that progression that you have to make when you are gonna be hired in order to, you know, demonstrate a certain interest, which is very important right now when you try to address yourself, at least for the first time, to the market. Well, sales leadership, people management, creativity. I was always telling them this morning, guys, you need to be creative. You need to think out of the box because you are a problem solver. Basically, you cannot replicate time to time and time to time what you have done for a certain way to solve a specific problem, when after 1 year or 2 years, 6 months, you find another problem that it's quite similar to this. Because perhaps the circumstances or, you know, the people that is involved to solve the problem or anything, any other condition makes this just different. So you cannot just copy paste, right? And all of these kind of soft skills are really important nowadays. And I would encourage you at some point to think about them and to try to, you know, embed them into the way that you are addressing yourselves to the students in order to really give them examples on what are we talking about when we say all of this. Finally, and as you're going to have this presentation, this is going to go towards you. So I have listed the resources for instructors that I recall. And every single time that I made this presentation, all of a sudden it comes to me another one. So there are 20 plus, and let me just go very fast through them. So remember that we have training processes for instructor trainers managed by the Cisco TFE team. Echo and Kristen are the ones here in the US. So if you want to become an instructor trainer, just let Kelly know, and Kelly will take care of this in order to inform either way Jesse, Marie, or myself, and we will inform Echo that we have another candidate, another instructor who is willing to become instructor trainer. This is a absolutely free process, but it's not an easy one. But it is true that also gives a lot of chances now more than ever to the ICTs to count with, you know, instructors who can open new courses for new instructors. Global IPD Week, if you have not attended, here you have the link for the last one, but it's coming soon. Vouchers discount. Remember that we went from the percentage. We were saying 63%, 60 to 63% to students and 70% to instructors. And this changed completely. And now it's a close price that we have stated for students, for instructors and instructor trainers, as you can see. And you can have here, I just place you the Prism View page with the vouchers price list for your convenience. Packet Tracer, you know that Packet Tracer has changed dramatically in this last version, and I hope that you really like it. I think that it's an amazing simulator now. It's approaching at some point VR, no? And now it's more, I would say, image friendly, if you will. And it's more attached to the real equipment that you or your students may find in the lab. And if you have anything, by the way, that it's any comment when you use it, that it's gonna help us improve it, please just bring that idea or bring that comment to us and we will share it with the team. So the monthly webinars of La Comunidad en Español, this is another very interesting resource in the case if you have students. They are doing super nice webinars monthly, very interesting ones. So if you have students who speak in Spanish or are learning Spanish, just let them know. DevNet, as you know, well, this resource is free at no cost for both students and instructors from Netacad. And now it's a very, I would say, relevant resource for you guys. Then we have WebEx, as you know now. Well, these were the two links that we have been serving during COVID. Now you know that WebEx is going to be embedded in our new LMS. So you're going to have basically a WebEx account in order to make your classes with your students at no cost. But it's a great investment that we are convinced that it's gonna help dramatically to address this post-COVID hybrid model learning, you know, that you will have probably to stay in. Grants for instructors training, you just saw it regarding the HBCUs, but it can be any other kind of grants. Hackathon Playbook, it's another kind of resource nice resource, I meant to say, for you if you want to organize, let's say even a creathon, right? You want to make a competition between your own students, or you guys get in touch between you and another instructor in another institution, and you say, why don't we make a competition between your students and my students? Okay, cool. Let's find out a problem. Let's see what kind of solution they come with. And this hackathon playbook is going to help you to know which are all those things that you have to consider if you want to make that competition successful in terms of organization. Webinars with Cisco experts to support your educative labor with students. So if at any time, at any point you say, man, I would like to know more about how nowadays all this world of IoT, it's being really, you know, set up and put in terms of being a project in the market. So, and I need one expert that it's, you know, with the boots on the field, on the mud, and just trying to deal with customers every single day and to know more, no? And let the students make the questions. So we can always organize it. You just have to tell us. Talent Bridge, as we have just seen. Then we have the Netacat Awards. Remember, there are awards that you can, present yourself for, or you can even get them automatically because you have achieved a certain number of open classes or number of students or student completions, as we were seeing before, or your attendance to the IPD week or the seniority in the program, or the participation in liability, limited availability, or participation in pilots or best practices. So all of these are kind of awards that we are giving to instructors. Then there are the Netacat resources that you all know that you have. The Facebook page for Netacat instructors in both English and Spanish. The Netacat newsletter. Then we have the GoToMarket Hub. So this is for ASC and ITC only. It's true. But I have to put it here because at some point, Kelly, in this case, is the one who has access to this GoToMarket Hub. And there are presentations that perhaps, you know, he can share with you because our, you know, the learning portfolio. There are the catalog, the product catalog. So things like that can be shared by ASCs to the academies, but this is a proper way, you know, to go through the branches throughout this tree that is the program. The quarterly US-Canada meeting and global meetings. So this is, again, is just for ASCs and ITCs, but I need you to know that, those who are part of the ASCs and ITCs are also instructors, right? So when they attend over there, they gather a lot of information, which is shared, by the way, with you through the newsletter that I have already mentioned. But perhaps you will listen part of this information coming from also your partners. Events, just to let you know that we have the US-Canada Partner Summit, which is for ASCs and ITCs only with Cisco. And well, meetings like this one, okay, that we can call them Instructors Day, or we can call them conferences, or whatever you want to call them, but are these kind of events as the one that we are in today for instructors. The dashboard to monitor academies' performance, the best practices shared with Netacat community of academies, instructors, and students. So here you have a couple of links that can be worthy for you. The marketing toolkit. There's plenty of resources, and we are adding new ones time to time in the marketing roundtables. The digital badges as well. So here you have a link to a very interesting page in which you will find all the badges, even the ones that are for instructors only, that you can earn. Okay. So, well, this is it. This was my presentation. Let me see if I can see how I just stop sharing.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Did I stop sharing?
Yep, and I'm going to go back and share my screen too, which let me actually close this out real quick.
Hey, Kelly, don't miss that message, or everyone, don't miss that message from Mike Smith wanting to get more explanation of GTM.
I did it. GoToMarket. It's the GoToMarket Hub, which is responsible for it's really where they put out a lot of the early marketing materials for new offerings like DevNet or things that are being offered. And then most of the time I turn around and send those back out to academies. So there's also been a good discussion on the chat about in the state of North Carolina, double majors. And that may be something that we'll pull out to a different discussion later. But it's something we have been able to do. There have been some issues I know in the past in North Carolina with double majors and the inability for financial aid to pay for double majors. So many times we've had our students not declare their second major until their final semester in the first major, and then they get their second. So I don't know if that's changed. I know Harry and Patty had mentioned that there were some things different there. David is saying that also at Johnson Community College, the financial aid is paying for both. So, okay. So it says, Constance says that, that double major depends on the way your college puts it in the program. So if your college doesn't support it, well, you may want to work with one of the schools work with the school.
Hey Kelly.
Yeah, go ahead, Constance.
So it depends. Basically, it comes down to if they put it in as your tracks being, or the different variations within the A25590 being one degree or being separate, whether they're doing the letter codes after or not. Some colleges are and some colleges aren't. I've had this argument with my registrar. Mine won't budge.
Yeah,
so mine won't put it in. So they can only get certificates in the other areas. They can't get two full degrees.
Now, if it's for financial aid, and that's where we're limited when my students on financial aid, that's where they can only be in that double major in their final semester of the first major they chose. Then they could double major and then start the second major in that very last semester.
So it sounds completely like it's dependent upon your college. So, but if you maybe can get them to work to where they do it as the umbrella, especially in North Carolina, it would technically still be the same major. It would just be, they would be under two concentrations in that same major.
Yeah, it's not even a financial aid issue for us. They can't be declared as both in the system because there's only one degree. So they're all of the different tracks are coded as the same thing. They can't be coded as both because they're the same thing.
Yeah, Mike, go ahead and unmute yourself if you have a question there, Mike. Go ahead.
Yeah, I do have a question. It's related to this, actually. So one of the things we've tried to do for students who are interested in pursuing both both degrees, and there is a lot of overlap, obviously, but what we're coming up against with respect to the financial aid issue is they will not pay for classes that are not in a particular track. So how do we finesse this so that, like when you said final semester, I'm like, what? I would love to know this, because if we can sort of guide students to this sort of double major, find a way to sort of double track it, they can get financial aid all the way through.
Right. And that's I know we do that here, our final. Yeah. So thank you, Monica. No problem at all. I understand you needed to go. So we'll gather any questions and send them to you. So, all right, I'm going to hold on 1 second. I'm going to actually make you remove co-host to make sure you don't leave and close the meeting for us. So I got it. Now you're
good. No, please.
You're good. If you need to leave, you can go. Mike, let's circle back, Mike, and we'll work on that at our level, because that's more of a North Carolina thing. But I do know that it is possible. We just got to figure out how to help you get it done. Okay. Any other questions? If not, okay. Thank you so much, Monica. I know you had to leave. Brian, I'm going to hand it over to you and let you take over and share your screen. Brian's going to talk about equipment ordering and NetAcad maintenance.
All right, stop your share, that way I can. All right, so most of us have at some point in time had to order equipment. It does change. We've had multiple vendors we've worked with, and I'll go over two of the vendors have been really a good working relationship with, and whenever we've needed them, especially during COVID, with not even Cisco items, but just equipment-wise, they've been really easy to work with. So we'll talk about equipment information, just cover quite a few different areas here. So under the marketing, list resources, marketing, and program resources, if you select equipment information, it'll come down to this list. Each one of these questions are pretty much answered for you in that list. First one is which Cisco software is supported, and it goes through, and there's actually a PDF, and I'll show you where the PDF is during this short PowerPoint presentation, but it'll go through and list even back into CCNA 6, and we'll talk about CCNA 7, still talks about CCNA security. It does also get into with the new network essentials. So we'll get into that. So this one here, it's for now, it's only software
that's available for the Cisco products that are aligned with the Cisco Academy. So the 2960s, the 4221s, the new ISR 4221s, 4321s, 4331s, I think. You can still go back and get the 2901 router software and 2911s. And as of now, I'm still going to support Kelly. You can jump in, but right now it's they're looking at supporting, still supporting the 2901s to an extent. 2911s, or am I incorrect on that? You may have stepped away for a second. The Academy itself, and everybody knows, if you don't know, it's free. And as far as their CSR, they do really well about providing academies with the resources necessary to not only use their LMS, but also the software provided through Cisco. When you're downloading or needing the Cisco software itself, you're going to use your same username, or actually it's going to, you know, your full email. So if you haven't seen that note at the top of Netacad, whenever you log in now, you'll need to know your current email address that's aligned with your Netacad account. So for your students, they can't, but they're going to get to a point where they can't use their username, so they have to use their email and the current password. Your current password will work with Cisco.com to where you can download the software. Let's see. The embedded Cisco software just gets into who has the equipment. If the equipment, I would say if the equipment transfers from, and I know we do transfers with equipment from location to location. So I would say that that license that you have, if you do that, you have to download a new license for any equipment you currently have. But for your new equipment, you would, again, go to use your email address that's aligned with your account and the current password you have, and you download the software that you need to get up and running. And the new ISRs are not the easiest to install and license. So the email that and information that Kelly shared over time about licensing those new ISRs are definitely follow those to a T, because you can mess a ISR or router up pretty easily.
Remember, these are images for classroom use only. That's why you're not going to see anything, but what's any image that's listed in those spreadsheets will be the images that are there. That if you need an image that's not on that spreadsheet, it's not covered. So that it only covers the images that are used in the classroom itself.
Okay, so Kelly, the 2901s and 2911s, are we going to be able to use those for the CCNA 7? You can. I think we can still use them the first and second course, and then part of the third course.
I don't know. I mean, they will do most of what's in one. Actually, do most of what's in 1, 2, and 3. So I know they've worked in NetLabs to make a pod type that uses the older routers, 2911s, 2901s. They are EOL or EOS, and definitely headed toward EOL end of life. So yes, that those will stay there for a while, but I would not depend on them for, you know, once they go end of life, they'll come off. There'll be no more software updates for them.
Yeah, and for us at Stanley, and I'm not sure if how you're planning. This goes for everyone that's responsible for ordering, but you're planning for your classrooms, COVID money. If you've got budget available, I would say be preparing now for getting back to see the classes. We're going to try, I guess, for fall, and Adam can jump in if he's still on the call, for seated classes there as much as possible. Luckily, we were able to do spring classes. Michael actually taught the second and third class for me in the program, I mean, on the curriculum side. So I definitely use any funding you have there. So this question right here, do we need to purchase service for Network Academy lab equipment? No, there are. You don't need to purchase a service, but if you're going to have lab equipment in your labs, you will need to purchase those lab devices. And then any support that you need will come from the Cisco Networking Academy regarding iOS images, any technical issues you have, and that will go through their support desk.
Brian, let me step in here real quick. Okay. I get this question all the time. Should I buy SmartNet? I typically buy 1 year of SmartNet on the gear I buy. And then if, or I'll take the money I would have used for that SmartNet and buy a couple extra routers and a couple of extra switches. I don't buy more than 1 year of SmartNet. Now we're at a level where we've got enough equipment that I can go get another switch if I need one. Now, if I only had, let's say I'm a small school and I literally have six switches. And I know that I'm not going to be able to get any more and I can't afford to keep any on the shelf as a spare. That is a situation where having SmartNet may be more important, because I've literally called at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, went through the process and had a new router sitting on my doorstep before I got to work the next day at 9 o'clock in the morning. Okay. So if you're in a very small school and you don't have the ability to keep a couple pieces of extra gear, or that can be a problem, then SmartNet makes more sense. There's a point though where SmartNet doesn't economically make a bunch of sense. I know Cisco probably doesn't like me saying this, but quite honestly, if it gets to the point I could have bought 3 or 4 extra routers and kept 1 or 2 on the shelf, I mean, you know, that's where you're into the 6 half dozen. The other elephant in the room here is what Rick Hooker, thanks Rick, has asked me, which is, what is the replacement for the 2960? All right, there is no official word as to the replacement on the 2960. I'm going to explain to you one thing, however. The 2960 is EOS, end of sale this year. That means, in fact, it's end of sale on October 31st of 2021, I believe, which means the end of life of that piece of gear is 5 years from that date. So October of 2026. I'll be retired, so I really don't care at that point. All right. But just so you know, the gear will be available, you know, support for the 2960s will exist until 5 years past end of sale, which will be 2026. Having said that, there is a replacement for the 2960 on the non-Cisco Academy side, which is a particular switch that I shall not name, but you can research it and see for yourself. I am purchasing a couple of those myself to play with, and there's no discount on them. So at this point, there's zero discount on that switch if you want to get one of them that's a 301,000C. But if you do, but I cannot even guarantee you that's going to be the replacement. All right. I'm just telling you that right now, we don't know what the replacement is. There is a replacement on the corporate side that they suggest for the 2960. Honestly, I think the 2960s for the next 5 years will be fine for everything we do in CCNA. Where I think those of you who are out there doing some of the CCNP labs are wanting a replacement for the 3760s and the other CCNP multi-layer switches. That's where things get a little fuzzier. And that's probably going to be a bigger issue down the road. But right now, we just bought four things of gear, and I bought 8 2960s. We bought 2960s and we'll continue to do so until they tell us midsummer, hopefully, is what they're going to tell us what the replacement will be for the 2960s.
Okay, thank you.
Terry says, do I have all that information in a written summary? I do not. Now, end of life and end of sale, all of that information is on Cisco's website.
Yep.
But I can, if we have to do it, if you want it.
All right. So talking about your maintenance, you'll need to verify this if you have not done this. When you get a chance, log into Cisco.com, select your managed profile, which is in the top right corner. And then under that, you'll see that next to your personal, you'll see access management. If you've not looked at this, you need to do this whenever you have a chance. I verified mine a while ago, and I do have this access. Once you select the access management, you will notice that you have been assigned, and most all instructors with the NetAcad at this time should be assigned this contract number, the 956-984-96. That is for any of the devices that are aligned with Cisco Networking Academy and the equipment that are in your labs, whether it's 2960s, 2901s, 2911s, or the newer item that's being recommended, especially for CCNA 7 as it changes. That will give you the option through Cisco.com to download and access the software or the iOS software you need for those devices. The So here it's talking about you gain access to the software updates through the Cisco website once you've joined the Cisco Networking Academy Maintenance Program. Yes, okay. This only went into effect within the last year, if I'm correct on that, Kelly, because when they went over to the single sign-on with Cisco, that's when it gave you the option to have access to the iOS software via Cisco.com as a Networking Academy instructor.
No, it's been true for any, NetAcad maintenance has been in existence for years and years. As long as you were under the NetAcad maintenance, then you were able to access Cisco.com. It just wasn't the same login. You just had to log in with a different login. Now with SSO, it's all the same login. Question from David. By the way, the main contact is who has to give your instructor account access to NetAcad maintenance or request it. There's an entire process. Brian will show you where that's at on the Cisco site, or I can here shortly. Okay. But the main contact can also be someone under the maintenance. So I'm an instructor and the main contact, and I've got that contract number under my account. So yes, you can be both, David.
And we'll share this, but again, this is in that marketing and under equipment information under your once you log in network NetAcad. Your sign up instructions for the Cisco Network Academy maintenance service can be found. You're going to have it as an instructor, academy administrator, using the academy name, ID number. That main contact will have a list of all the instructors who will be representatives, and they can send a support desk ticket if you do not have it to get you access to it.
And that's one thing that's important. Go back just one slide there, Brian. If you are an existing academy and have been for some time and you've added new instructors, they're not automatically given NetAcad maintenance access. So if you're the main contact, you will need to go and create inside of here, you know, find your academy name and ID and create a help desk ticket and say, I need to add the following instructors at my school. And I would give their name, their academy ID, and tell them that they need a NetAcad maintenance, and then they can actually give it to those new instructors. So it's not automatic for anybody who's under your academy.
All right. So here, just the support desk will review it, and then the contact is sent a copy of all the conditions, and then the correspondence between the support and the main contact will get that fixed for everyone. Again, what are the benefits for this? Ability to download supported versions of Cisco software, access to enable technology packages, especially when you get into security K9s and the packages you need for the lab, not only just CCNA 1, but CCNA 1, 2, and 3. So we'll get into that PDF here shortly. This just goes through what is the Cisco Network Academy Maintenance, ability to download the software, ability to enable technology packages, program support using the support desk, and that is phenomenal. I'm just going to be honest with you. Very, very easy to work with. Send them an email. They're going to respond to you, and then going to follow up with you and make sure everything is, for us, that they follow up, make sure everything's working as it's supposed to. And it is available to all academy organizations and instructors at no cost after your program registration. This is just the way to get to it. Again, resources, marketing program, equipment information, and then your network academy maintenance. All right, so for equipment, again, where do you find equipment information for your network academy courses? Again, it's marketing, going to My NetAcad. Once you log in NetAcad, doesn't matter if you're at I'm Teaching or not, it's under resources, marketing and programming resources, and then the equipment information. Here, this gives you the option to see equipment list by curriculum, the Cisco equipment ordering processes by region, and the networking academy maintenance. Here's the list, the equipment list by curriculum. So whether it's CCNA 7, Network Essentials, still has IT Essentials, even though that's going into from an instructor led to a self-paced, it's still there. If you're going to still be using that in your course programs or continuing education, however, whichever side you're teaching on. And then once you've got to this point, here is the current list as of today. Now, the last modified date is very important because if you're looking at the the CCNA 7 equipment list is saying the last time it's been updated is November 2019. It could be updated tomorrow. So you can download the Excel spreadsheet and use it, but I would recommend that each time you're needing to go and look at the equipment information, go back to this location, because any of the most current or the current and most up-to-date item is going to be here. They just updated the, this may not be the newest one either. I think they got the new CCMP information in here. I think that screenshot's actually old, so I'll have to update that one. This is, and I'll select it. I don't know if you'll be able to see it. I bet you're not going to be able to see it, right, Kelly? Let me stop share for a second. All right, when I selected that link, it took me to, again, all resources, program resources, equipment information, equipment ordering, this PDF. All right, so that PDF, once you've opened it, and I'm going to stop my share again. I apologize.
There's a good question in chat about who supports the NetAcad maintenance, and that is on a per academy basis. So your school has to request and add people to the NetAcad maintenance.
All right, so this is in my PowerPoint, but I was going to let you know, once you selected that link that's in NetAcad, it's going to open the current version of the lab equipment promotion ordering information. All right.
I want to make a quick point here, Brian. Notice this is, a lot of people will see this, especially some of you that are bigger schools, and go, only 10 CCNA bundles. What? I've just got $500,000 in COVID money. That's 10 per quarter.
Per order.
So you could technically buy 40, I guess, a year, which would be nuts, but you can do it. Just be aware there are limits, and it can be, if you suddenly have that amount of money, there are ways for our CSRs to go and say, hey, we need to bump this up a little bit. So if you've got a really large project, just be aware that is part of it.
Okay, I'm going to stop and share, go back to my PowerPoint. That way
I'm
staying on one item here.
And I would also say again, each one of those in the CCNA has the 4221s, 4321s, or 4331s. I would avoid the 4321s like the plague, because their form factor is weird and they don't fit well in data center environment. So,
all right. Another thing to kind of talk about is your eligibility. All Academy member institutions, CCNA trained instructors, this will be lab equipment you have access to, CCNA security, which again, you still, if you're teaching CCNA security, you're still there, the new CCMP, and now network essentials.
This, and I want to make a point here too. Notice that says a CCNA trained. So if you are an academy that is only offering the non-career ready path, in other words, you're only doing the courses that do not qualify for career ready, you don't qualify for the equipment donation, or not donations, but equipment promotions. You must have an instructor who's at least finished CCNA 1 or in CCNA 1 before CSRs will actually approve equipment purchases.
The this link here, this locator.cloudapps link, is how you actually identify partners that you were able to order from. And there's the actual full address. What Kelly was saying was the product limits per quarter. Now, once I selected that link, I entered our address for Stanley with 28001. There was nothing close, so it put in the location of United States. I put in education and then selected search. When I did that, it came up with, I think, 1,229. I think it's 1229, maybe 120, a different partners that are available to order from. And this is me, and I don't know, Kelly may step in here and add to it. I would say order from the gold partners, because those are the ones that have direct, have worked with the relationship with Cisco directly and get better, I would say better deals. They're still going to provide the same discount. I think all of them will have to, if they're listed under that, they'll provide the same discount. We just have been very fortunate and had really good working relationship with Converge One CDW.
And we also have a new one now, Infranet in North Carolina, in Virginia and South Carolina. I would say not necessarily gold partners, but shop around. Just because the discount is supposed to be 60% minimum off list. That does not mean they won't give you more. So I would say get quotes even, and I recently got quotes from three different vendors and got three different prices, even though they were all using the same quote, the discount voucher. So now, good question by Bill says, these partners that may not be the same where a college buys gear. That is true. It may not be, Bill, and it may be, though, that you want to find out who your college uses and then say, this, hand them that Netacad promotion discount PowerPoint or information, because any partner can provide you that discount. All they have to do is search and find out that you're an academy, and they can give you 60% off list. Some of them will give you 60% off list and maybe even a little more. Some of them won't. So it could be your local normal everyday Cisco partner that sells gear to your school. And it may not be now, and you may be in a situation like we are where the vendor has to be on a state contract, but you also need to realize that you can say that these are single source vendors because they are providing the special discount using that academy discount. So I would say shop around. That's a big thing. And just get multiple quotes, even though you should get, you know, 60% off list, but that doesn't mean that you won't get other folks. So
yeah, and I just put the contacts of who we've dealt with, Sonia Godoy at Converge One and Mark Santa Romita. They've been really good to us. Now this may not be your actual contact, but this is just who we've dealt with. Here is the information that's in that PDF regarding the CCNA 7. This talks about the, there's three different options. Here's the first one using the 4221s. Kelly said that if you don't have to get the 4221s and you have it in your budget to get either the 4321s or the 4331s, we recommend that, but this is just one of the options. Still using that 2960. Now, the wireless router portion, we don't have that in my lab. You may have the wireless router in your lab. We've actually purchased two, but we're going to have for fall this semester, we'll have the wireless router in there. So this is just the first recommendation. This is the one with the 4321.
Don't do the 4321s unless you hate yourself.
Because that's the one with the external power supply, right?
Yeah, external power supply and no easy way to mount it. Good question from Mike. How are we integrating the wireless in the net labs? We're not. You're using Packet Tracer or you're using some other simulation engine because there is no integrating wireless into net labs. You know, technically you could build a Faraday cage and put it inside of there and do it. So, I mean, honestly, you could put wireless into a net labs pod, no problem. The problem becomes, though, again, you'd have to have a Faraday cage or something to capture the signals inside of there, but we're not. If you got the money, the 4331s are a full 19-inch rack mount, and they're nice, but they're a little more expensive. So,
all right, so that's the one that Kelly's recommending. Here are the again going into the NIM 2T, the WAN cards. Most everything we're using is Cat 6, Cat 5, Cat 6.
Yeah. You don't need any serial cards anymore. But I will warn you this. Especially if you're a new academy, no router ships with a console cable anymore. So if you are a new academy and you're ordering gear, you need to get console cables, order console cables. If you are like us, you've got a billion console cables hanging around everywhere, then you know you don't have a problem with it. But just be aware that that is something that started a couple years ago.
And then it also goes in the optional equipment for NetLab Plus if you have that. Here's the additional, the hardware, PC. Again, you're going to have the software license if it's a Windows virtual machine you're using. This talks about Packet Tracer V7.3, but now with version 8 out there, and it's using that require, I guess it's pushing everyone to the physical portion of a packet tracer. That's where they're able to show the actual rack and stack of equipment. So it's PT8 there. Here are the three notes, just going over, you can look at that later. Other lab configurators that are included in the current PDF is CCNA Security 2.0, CCNP Enterprise, and Network Essentials. I just didn't include them in this packet, in this PowerPoint itself. And that's it. So stop my share. And anybody got questions, concerns? All right, all yours, Kelly.
Okay, I just posted a quick item, folks, on chat. See if anybody answers it to win a pie top. If you give me the answer, first one to answer that. Oh, Kirby got it. Packet tracer, physical mode, PTPM. So Kirby's Academy has won a pie top. Kirby, email me your mailing address or just drive down here and get it. I'll probably make you drive down here and get it because you're close enough. All righty. Any questions on equipment, folks? Anybody have any questions at all for Brian? Again, I strongly suggest shopping around. You also, one of the things I will tell you is, obviously, if you're like us, you need a good working relationship with your purchasing folks. So buy them copious amounts of food and make sure you take care of them because they take care of you when it comes time to go buy equipment. Any questions? Do we have a new equipment list on the CCNP side? Yes, that is already out there, I do believe. If I go into here, and I should have already been logged in, but it logged me out for some reason. Under all resources, program resources, equipment information, equipment list by curriculum, we should see CCNP Enterprise is right here, February 2020. This is the current list as of February 2020 for CCNP Enterprise. And there it is. Encore or ENARSI requires the same, 3 4221s or any version similar. So it could be any of the 4221s or 4321s or 4221s. And you'll notice one of the differences between CCNP and CCNA is CCNP does require serial cables. Okay, so this is a difference in CCNP versus CCNA. The CCNP requires those serial connections to do the labs. Even though in the real world, where most people have gotten away from it, that is required. So again, remember you can always go under all resources and then go to equipment and you can find all the equipment lists.
Kendra's got a good question in regards to equipment that's no longer needed. For me, when I'm, especially in the seated classrooms, I'll have students get the old equipment out and play with it just to see it, put it in and create just different networks. Have them, they can sit it on their table that they're working at just so they can see the different varieties of equipment that were predecessors to the current equipment they're using. Now, you can... I guess take it off inventory and then send it back to the state recycling.
Yeah. The other thing I would say is this, if you have a large amount of old gear, like 2900s or, there's stuff that you need to get rid of, you may want to just contact me and then let's talk about finding another school in the state of North Carolina that has very little equipment and see if we can't transfer it to that new school. Because again, some of that older stuff will still do a great deal of what we do in CCNA. So if you've got a lab full of stuff, and I'm talking to myself too, because we got a lab stacked full of stuff, let me know and let's try to move that gear around to some of the schools that may not be as blessed, especially high schools. In state North Carolina. Even if you can take it off or that, or hosting net labs for and others, yeah, we could use it to host depending on that. Mike had a good question. Are you offering CCNP at the community college level? We do not anymore. I'm offering the instructor trainer classes. I got one class now and one class will be in this summer. It just depends on their, what happens with, CML and with some other projects, but we don't offer it at this moment. There are schools that do offer it. If you do offer it at the community college level, post, I know, Fay Tech, Wake Tech does, So I know there's a good number of schools in this, at the state level that are doing it, but they're offering, most of them are offering it at the in their continuing education departments, not in their two-year degree programs. All right. Any other questions? Mike, definitely we'll talk about that, talk about the possibility of getting some of that gear. All right. I know most of you are already very familiar with DevNet, but I do want you to know I'm going to go over some things here because I want to just mention you received last week, if you're in North Carolina, a letter that was messed up about 226. NET 226 has been renamed Network Programmability, and it does actually have a course description that is Network Programmability, not the old NET 226. So hopefully you saw that updated email that went to your chief academic officer. But if you're looking for something to go into your fourth course, DevNet is definitely an option. So again, if you ever need anything, folks, go to course resources and go to the course. This, by the way, is also where you can see whether or not a course requires you to be certified as an instructor or accredited, not certified, but accredited. So this says you must be accredited. You must also have an affiliation with the Academy Support Center to offer this class. So what I want to do is, if you haven't or are not familiar with DevNet, I'm going to take you into a DevNet class and just show you my DevNet show and tell. Woohoo! So this DevNet course is designed for you to offer a network programmability course to your students. I pulled this document straight out of the information about, please tell me you can see my document here. DevNet product, got it? Okay.
Yes.
So it is designed for, and I get that for some reason, bringing together the worlds of networking and coding. I'm going to blow through some of this, but the 1.0 course, target audience is 2 to 4 year, and it's a 70-hour full course. Obviously it can be taught in more. You notice that one of the recommended items for it is to take PCAP Programming Essentials first, which is a good thing we're already doing in the state of North Carolina for our high school students, right? Question.
Hey, Kelly.
No, I cannot do that. I am sorry, but unless you are in the course itself, taking the course to become accredited, I cannot give you access to the course. I know there's ways to download what I have showing you here, but unless you're taking the course, I really can't give you access to the content of the course. Now, having said that, we've got the course this summer. There are, I think, 6 slots still available in the DevNet course. So you could take it this summer if you would like to do so. The other ones here you'll notice is Introduction to Networks. So I'm saying that a student who's had the first 3 courses of CCNA or even the first 2, you would be well prepared to do DevNet Associate. Is there a plan for having more labs of DevNet in PT? I don't know. Not really, because many of the labs don't even require gear. They just require a programming interface. And I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But there's 8 modules. There's 23 hands-on labs, 5 packet tracer activities. The good thing about this course is it requires 0 real Cisco equipment. All right. So when you go to teach this class in the first chapter, the first thing you're going to do is you're going to be taught how to set up VirtualBox to support this course. For most of the course, this is all you need, is access to this one virtual machine right here. And this is provided to you, and you load it in VirtualBox. By the way, there's also a VMware workstation or workstation image that you can use. But this is the primary unit that is used for the first 7 really first 6 modules. Inside of here, you'll notice they put there's actually a specialized version of Packet Tracer. There's also, you've got Visual Studio on here, and you have the ability, by the way, if you didn't know Visual Studio Code, you can actually load on any machine. But this is just one of the basic areas to where you can set up, and use for your coding environment. So this is something that is, didn't mean to hit that, is very easy to set up and use, and you can save and do all your work in here. But this particular VM is very easy to set up. Once you get up into the later sections, you will have to download this Cisco 1000V. Now, the 1000V is a virtualized iOS, and you will not be able to get this if you do not have Academy maintenance. That's why I had Brian go over Academy maintenance. Alzir asked, what is the VMware images to use? What's VMware images to use? It's in the listing. It's just an OBA that you deploy into Workstation for VMware. But I'm going to show you something else that we're working on too, that's kind of neat. But you'll notice that this has 56101. I can go back over to this DevNet machine, and I actually have the ability, because the way these are deployed, they're deployed into VirtualBox with the ability to actually access one another. And so you have the ability from the PC to access the 1000V and, wrong credentials. I put in wrong ones. I'll get in there in a second. Hold on a minute. But what actually, once you're able to get in here and do this, you're able to access it and do the labs. So when you do a programmability lab where you deploy a RESTful API or you deploy a Python program onto the 1000V, you have access with VirtualBox. Each one of these images takes about 4 gigs of RAM. So be aware that that is one of the items that is important for you to know. So this is the straight off of the DevNet course information. It's the lab fact, but it talks about what is available and what it is. It goes through in very fine detail what is in here. So the DevNet lab VMs, custom built Ubuntu with all of these items installed. So Python, pip, the virtual environment, all of that's in there. VS Code so that you can do the Python extensions. Postman so you can work with the APIs. And so on and so forth. All of that is available on that one machine that you deploy, and it's very, very easy to deploy. It is literally going in here and saying file, import appliance, and you can import it in. And it's almost the exact same thing under VMware Workstation. Okay. Is the DevNet course instructor letter self-paced? All right. That is the another $27,000 question. There is a way that they have made the DevNet available for you self-paced, but here's what you have to do. If you want to become accredited for DevNet self-paced, you take the self-paced course, then you have to go pass the DevNet exam, and then you have to find an ITC that will provide you with the hands-on exam, or just take the class at an instructor training center, okay, and finish it. Bob's got a really good point too. You're taking the DevNet with us, and they need some programming 115. I agree with that. I agree 100%. The Cisco Python, the programming Python in this DevNet course is pretty high. So I would strongly suggest that too. But it's that's the two ways that you can get certified. You can do it self-paced, but if you do it self-paced, you must pass the certification exam and then get an ITC to basically fast track you, or just take the class, finish it, complete it successfully, then you're accredited, and then you can go pass the exam at your own leisure when you want to do that. Bob and Neil, you're both in the class. Feel free to come off mute and give us an opinion of the class for DevNet if you would like to. But I will say here, you'll see that the DevNets, those images take 4 gigs each. For the first 6 chapters, pretty much, you only need the one DevNet VM, the DevSpax VM. So you really only need 4 gigs free so your students can download this image. And then the same thing is true once you get into module 7 and 8, your students the students would have to have 8 gigs of RAM. And I saw Mike saying I was the worst instructor. I'm not even teaching that class. So, man, take that.
I can make a quick comment on the class if you want, Kelly. This is Neil.
Yeah, Neil, go ahead.
Yeah, we're taking the DevNet class now with Dan. It's a great class. As you said, there's just, you know, compared to the CCNA, which has got like, you know, 43 or 33 modules, there's only eight modules, but they're long. They're very, very long. So it's been long. And you're right. These VMs are easy to load up. They're just an OVA file. You import it, you're done. So all the tools and libraries and utilities you need are within that VM. It's like contained. But it's a great class. We talk about, you know, Docker and containerization and Python, and obviously it's a network automation class, programmability. It's really good. It's a really, really good class.
Good.
Great knowledge, great skill set to have.
And I would say if you are looking for a fourth class, it would make a great fourth class, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree, because the end of the, it's a good point, Kelly, the end of the CCNA 3 is, you know, is programmability and automation, and it introduces, you know, Ansible and Puppet and Chef and programmability. And so right after that, if you were to take another semester, another module for 70 hours and lead it to DevNet, that's ideal.
Yep. Good question. The labs says there are some labs, configure routers and switches. Well, the way this particular class works is exactly like this. You've got this machine, the DevAsk lab VM, and you've got the Cisco 1000V. The 1000V is the router that you are, and actually if I do a show run, you will see that down here, it's got Yang, Netconf, and ResConf are all turned on. So it is actually configured so that you can connect to it and push configurations and pull configurations on and off of this device. So you don't have to have any other equipment at all. So this is basically with VirtualBox, you can have your students running this class at their house in this COVID environment, as long as they had enough RAM to run it. Now, if they've got a laptop with only 8 gigs of RAM, they're probably going to be fine as long as they're running just the first 6 modules. But as soon as they try to run both VMs, they may get themselves into trouble. So module 7 and 8. Having one of the reasons I mentioned that is because we are working with NDG on, lo and behold, a DevNet pod for NDG that will have a workbench on it. By the way, they take the pretty pictures off because those pretty pictures are resource intensive when you're trying to deploy large amounts of pods. The 1000V only supports, only does routers, and there are no labs that have you actually pushing things out to switches. So the 1000V is a router only, but you can see here's the 1000V. PM brief, I can't type. Right, and you can see that there. And I'm gonna try to be a little more successful. I'm gonna try to remember the password on this thing to get over to it. If not, I'll just look at the content, and there's no content here because this is a 100% beta pod. But if you are in our classes, you actually have access to it. In fact, I gave access to my, I gave access to my CCNP students because there were some labs that were requiring network programmability. So there's going to be different ways for you to access this. And lo and behold, I think I finally got the password right. There you go. Thanks, Bob. Yeah, I had put a capital C. That's where I messed up last time. But you'll see this is the web UI on the 1000V. So the workbench is able to connect to the 1000V. And in fact, the other thing you'll notice here is that, if I'm not mistaken, you should be able to get a netacad.com, because there's a little firewall here, but you will not be able to get to cheese.com unless that's been opened up. Yeah. So there's only certain sites you can get to because there is a little firewall in this pod, but you can see this is the actual 1000V. So there's going to be different ways you can deploy this. Obviously the best thing though is, folks, for you, is you can deploy and use this class right now with no additional Cisco equipment. Questions about that? All right, let's dig just a little bit deeper and looking at these 8 modules. Now, like was said by Neil, there are only 8 modules, but there are some fairly long modules. You know, the first module gets you into creating your lab environment, then does an overview of labs. Basically your Linux abilities and your Python abilities. And there are a couple short labs there. Then we get into what is DevNet and how DevNet works. It actually, for this course, you have to create a DevNet account, which you will thankfully still use the exact same login as what you have for netacad.com and cisco.com, just be at DevNet. We get into what is software development. So for those of us who are, as I love what Bob said, it's a good class, but it's more for programmers with a bit of networking than networkers with a bit of programming. So I'm a networker with a bit of programming. And so this was a very new type thing for me here, looking at these software development, not just tools, but methodologies and ways to do it. I love the fact that it goes over Git though, because you have to create a Git account and then you actually use, there's a lab on how to do version control with Git, how to, you know, how to fork a project and all those. There are no switches in the DevNet class. There are only routers. If there are switches in the DevNet labs, then you can use the DevNet labs for that. But there are no switches in the DevNet curriculum. They use the 1000V to basically do everything that would be associated with the same process. If you can do it on a router, you can do it on a switch. For the most part, it's the same concept. You're just trying to either push or pull configs from a device. Now, I will say this, if you get in the DevNet itself, you're going to get into the fact that inside of there, they're going to be working on the iOS XE. They're going to be working on some of their very programmable switches like the 9000s. Folks, we can't afford 9000 series switches in our academies. You're looking at chassis that cost more than we probably put in our programs in a year. Now, there are some chassis that are cheaper, but those switches we just can't afford. So what they did is they did the best they could with the 1000V and are using it as a way to show you that programmability. But yeah, a Git, I love it. I mean, it's GitHub's a good tool. And so they teach how to use GitHub. They teach you about APIs, what they are. They teach how to do RESTful APIs and how to authenticate RESTful APIs and how to actually use RESTConf to connect to the 1000V to pull information and create new interfaces. In fact, if you did the emerging technologies workshop, many of the labs or some of the labs will look very similar to you because it is built right off of those. In fact, many of you are wondering, why did they do away with the emerging technology workshop, the RESTful programming with REST? Because here it is, it's right here. So they did away with that because there's no need to keep both open at the same time. Then there's a chapter that all of us networking geeks can ignore. This is just network fundamentals. So this is for that programmer with little networking. And then we get into the differences between how to do cloud deployments, how to do continuous integration and continuous deployments. Looking at security for application development, which is obviously a huge thing. As we look at developing apps. Then we move into DevOps and actually scripting and automation tools, some of the different things that Cisco has. And this is in module 7 where you have to install the 1000V. There's very detailed instructions on how to do that. And then we start looking at the workflow with Ansible and installing, using Ansible to install a web server and testing using PiATS. And then last but not least, we get into the software development tools and using NetComp, RESTComp, all to manage an iOS XE device and then using Python scripts to manage WebEx Teams. So you create a WebEx Teams account so that you can then use Python to like create a room, add people to a room. And years ago, I think it wasn't last year, but the year before, many of you may have been in my NCCIA emerging technologies workshops where I had to fill in for Echo on basically an overnight. And so we struggled through it, but we did a lot of that in that course. So they took some of that information and moved it into this new course. Okay, our programming, it says our program is separate. Are there any suggestions on how to pitch this to them and build a more integrated capstone? I think the big thing there is get them in this course and get them looking at it and seeing how, I think the big thing there is your programmers are going to be more and more DevOps people too. they're going to be asked to move into the DevOps side, or they're going to be opening up. I think you could say here is even another another way for your programmers to get a job, you know, another avenue. So, you know, you've got your programmer roles, you got your DevOps roles. I would say I'd go to that programming side and say, hey, have you ever thought about adding some DevOps so that your programming students would have another avenue to get jobs? And then Bob talks about a good thing, the hands-on is automating WebEx teams with Python, which is really cool, which is a lot of fun. It really is. Lab equipment, this is it, two VMs. Currently, you can roll it out in VirtualBox or in VMware Workstation, or there will eventually be a pod inside of NetLabs. Plus, be honest, if you know how to do custom pods in NetLabs, you can roll these things out yourself. But be aware, again, to get that 1000V and to be able to legally distribute the 1000V to your students for the class, you must have NetAcad maintenance. All right. And that this kind of goes through the rest here. I will tell you the one problem that we've seen, or I have seen students have with this particular course is, and this is just true of anything when you're using virtualization, some people have forgotten to turn on, or their machine ships with virtualization support turned off inside of the BIOS. The last time I taught CyberOps and had some students download, because CyberOps is the same way. You don't have to have any real gear. You can just download the VMs. But if for some reason you get an error and it will not boot up virtual machines, check your virtualization settings in your BIOS to make sure it is turned on. Bob says it's so easy on individual machines. I wouldn't mess with pods unless you have students with limited machines. I agree with you, Bob. I would say this. The only thing I would say is many students may not have 16 gigs of RAM. Mike says don't use Windows 10 Home. It's nasty. Yeah, that's an evil operating system. A good point, Bob. If they've got at least 16 gigs of RAM on their machine, they should be fine, shouldn't have any problem. The other thing I will say is even if you do have pods, it's not a bad idea to have them download and at least that first VM and install VirtualBox so they kind of get used to building their own environment, their own development environment locally, so that they see that and they see it on an integrated machine. And then they can start deciding for themselves. You know, every programmer has their own way in their own development environment. So that's how they can start seeing, you know, here is a pre-developed box for you, right? Here it is. It's got all the tools on it you want, but this may not be what you want in the real world. You may want to be able to do it, do whatever you want to. You may want different codes. You may want to use Jupyter Notebooks. You may want to use whatever, okay? So just be aware that is a possibility. And folks, that's kind of a deep dive on the DevNet. I don't really want to spend too much more time on it other than to say it is an option for you. It is, you know, obviously we've got all these check-in and different items with our secured final exams, and each one of these modules has these check your understanding. So it's a fully built out curriculum. Here again is a great question was asked earlier about how do we get training. There's two different ways. One is come take the class with us or any ITC. We do have it this summer, starting June 2nd, going through August 11th. And then once you finish the course and get accredited, you can go teach it right then. You also get a learning badge and a certification voucher if you make a 70 or higher on the final exam. Or you can go do the self-paced training and become DevOps certified. Or you can do get a remote ITC to proctor you, and then you will actually be accredited. All right. At this point, folks, I'm going to stop. I'm going to move back over to my PowerPoint and ask, are there any other questions? Any questions that you have for us for this second meeting? So we've lost some folks as the meeting's gone on. I understand that happens. I do want to kind of throw some things out there. Our summer ITC classes, I'll keep bringing this up, June 2nd through the 11th. There are only 7 slots left in DevNet and 8 in CyberOps Associate, and there are only 4 grant funding slots left. Keisha's asking, what courses are most colleges teaching DevNet? I think, Kendra, for us in the state of North Carolina now, it will be Net 226 because of the fact that, you know, if it gets approved. If it doesn't get approved, then I don't know. But Net 226 was rewritten to be network programmability. So I hope that works. And again, I hope everybody was happy with the rewrites for 126, 225, and 226. That's in state of North Carolina, folks. I try to incorporate everyone's feedback there. The last thing I did want to add in here, folks, is last week, Echo mentioned the Cisco Engineer, System Engineer Connect Phase 2 is now open. So if you are ready to start requesting system engineers for your class or classes, you can go and use this link right here, and it will give you a access to, and I'll jump out here to this, and then I will answer that question. Mike Gordon just asked, will there be an update soon for CCNA security? It is already updated. If you will go in here now, there is a new course called Network Security. And right here it is. So Network Security is this course right here. And this is the new rewrite that was released last week, in fact. Says, can we use Net 226 for the new IoT course? Corey, that would work, especially with the way I did the network programmability. I think it would still work. I wrote it with DevNet in mind, but I'm not so sure that you couldn't also use IoT in there because of the fact of the way it was written, that it would still apply. Last but not least, I do want to mention, go back to my PowerPoint. Oops, sorry. Here is that NetAcad Connect. So this is for North America, North, Central, and South America. You put in your name, your country, what you're looking for. You know, do you want a judge panel? Do you want to present a technical topic? You put in, you know, how many participants you expect, what you're looking for. And then what will happen is you will actually be contacted when a system engineer sees this. So what happens is when you submit it, system engineers look at this and say, hey, that's something I know about. I can do a presentation on REST comp or on programmability or whatever. And you can then set up that meeting with your instructors, with that system engineer and the instructor, and you can present, or they will present to your class. So this is now available for you to use. Last but not least, next week, our final, again, Cisco meeting. Will be same bat time, same bat channel, 4 to 6. We will be meeting again via Zoom. I'll send the link out next week, and I will also be sending out this recording, and I will be sending out any PowerPoints or items that I have that I can send to you. So next week, we'll try to have another CSR update from Maria. It'll probably be pretty short because most of the things have been covered, as Maria said. Then we'll start our roundtable with any of the CSRs who can show up. And also, we'll be here taking notes so we can post this. And, you know, I don't want it to be a general gripe-a-thon, but I do want you to be honest and tell us what you need in the academy and ideas, you know, productive ideas, especially for those of us as we continue to work in COVID. Then I'll do a short, quick show of what Cisco Modeling Labs is and some of the beta pods we've been working on. And then finish off with question and answers, just like we've had this semester or this semester, golly, this particular meeting. Are there any other questions? Anybody got any questions?
Yeah, Kelly, I do. It's Michelle.
Go ahead, Michelle. Yep, go ahead.
I had written in the chat, but any feel for how many community colleges here in North Carolina are going to do DevNet?
I do not have a feel. I think I'm probably 10, maybe. I think I'm feeling around 10 is kind of what I've heard around. You know, Mike says they're debating. You know, if you're a community college in North Carolina, throw in the chat what you're thinking. I would like for us to do it. I just don't know, since we dropped Net 226, I don't know if we'll be adding back in another course. So for us, it's up to Brian. I'm no longer program head of networking, so I don't know. But you know, that course could also fall in. That wouldn't be a bad course for security. You know, security area. So I don't know. So we don't have a general consensus on that. We're definitely going to offer it through continuing education. I'm going to offer it through my IT Academy. That's one of the things that we're going to do. So we're going to, we're definitely offering it in a continuing education environment. So I do know that. Okay, any other questions? Anybody else? Feel free to come off mute and ask it if you have one. Well, everyone, I cannot thank you enough for being here again this week. We had great participation. I think at the max, we had 36 folks on here. So again, that's amazing. I really appreciate you donating or spending 2 hours. You're not donating, but spending 2 hours with us during this meeting. And again, we're here. Anything we can do to help you, please contact us and we'll do as much as we can to try to help you out. I'm going to stop the recording.